Hello, I'm Elijah Henderson with the Cryptid Studies Institute.
And I'm Johnny Henderson from Cryptid Studies Institute. Normally we don't make an intro to one of our videos, but we thought that we had to in this case. We've been working on the Bell Witch, and we're trying to make it as comprehensive as possible. We were going to release it as a series, and we're going to release all parts at once. Unfortunately, since we've been working on this, we have been inundated with one disaster after another. Some people might say this video was cursed, and if we were those kind of people, we'd be inclined to believe. We've had loved ones die, cars blow up, supernatural happenings around our home, and my wife was diagnosed with cancer. I separated 5 ribs, and Elijah here literally almost lost an eye the other day during a freak accident while he had been working on the video. We hope that you like this. A normal script for us is about 15 pages and gives us an hour of documentation time or documentary time. But this script is over 80 pages right now and still going. We keep coming up with new information. I hope you like it. And if it seems like it starts out slow, just bear with it in the other parts, because it's going to tell a much broader story. This thing is as far-reaching as the Salem witch trials. It overlaps with cryptids and just about anything you can think of that you wouldn't normally associate with the Bell Witch. Do you have anything to add about this, Elijah?
Just that we will try to get these parts up as quickly as we can, so try to expect a fairly short time in between, because we'll be working hard on it. And
we expect probably 4 or 5, maybe even 6 parts.
Yeah, probably they're about an hour for each individual part.
Just bear with us, guys. We love you. And if you don't see your favorite part of the Bell Witch story in this video, it's probably coming.
More than likely, we've covered just about everything, every aspect of the legend.
Keep us in your thoughts and your prayers as we continue to do with it, because we've literally had what seems like supernatural happenings while working on this. Our grounds are covered with Christmas lights because my wife enjoys Christmas lights. And as we've been leaving in the evening and coming home, we've been finding the lights have been turning themselves on. And the button is extremely hard to push.
And where we live down in the woods too, with just a house up there and a house up there. Most likely it's neither one of them. So there's really not a whole lot of options for what it could be.
But 7 strands of lights at different times coming on.
And we want to demonstrate how difficult that would be for like a cat to jump up on it or something similar. Because this button is very stiff. It's not something that would just be easy to turn on.
And it would be highly unlikely for something to jump on 7 strands of lights when the controllers are hidden under our decks.
Yes.
There's been so much weirdness going on, things moving around the house, it seems like, shadows, shapes. We've jokingly started calling it Harriet.
Things sitting down in the bed, scratching noises.
Sounds of birds fluttering. I mean, we just normally don't get into the supernatural, but it really has been weird around here since we've been working on this video.
And it sounds like we're just making up stuff to go along with the video, but no.
I promise you that's not the case.
This is genuine truth.
Because we try to avoid the supernatural.
Yes.
But guys, once again, thank you. We love you. Please be patient with us.
Thank y'all. Hello, I'm Elijah Henderson from Cryptid Studies Institute here in mysterious Adams, Tennessee, where you may off in the background hear an annual bluegrass festival going on. As Halloween approaches, the season of the witch, we thought it well appropriate to bring you one of the most horrifying tales of the supernatural ever to seize upon mortal man. When you think of prolific accounts of otherworldly assaults, you will without surely allow your mind to wander to the notorious Amityville horror case, or even the alarming Haunting in Connecticut account. Yes, friends, the 19th century onslaught of demonic activity that beset itself against the Bell family makes them both pale in comparison. Yes, today we are talking about the Bell Witch of Adams, Tennessee.
Several years ago, there was a promotional television commercial for the Volunteer State that proudly promoted the tagline of "Follow me to Tennessee." And all that I can say is, why not visit Tennessee? For my money, there's no better place to be in the whole of the Union. After all, Tennessee is the home of Memphis and the Delta Blues, the home of Graceland and Real Foot Lake, the home of Nashville, the capital of country music, the Tennessee Titans, and the Nashville Predators hockey team. Tennessee houses the Appalachian foothills and the Great Smoky Mountains. Tennessee is full of breathtaking beauty and has a culture all its own. But some 200 years ago, Tennessee was home to something darker and more malevolent than anything else in the annals of American history. 2 centuries ago, a small town in Middle Tennessee was the locality of one of, if not the most prolific, haunting or oppression that has ever bothered daylight or that has ever been recorded, I dare say, throughout the history of the world. The events that transpired in that small rural town were so staggering, so jarring, that they gathered worldwide attention, and those attentions were pinpoint laser-focused on a wealthy landowner named John Bell and wife Lucy Williams Bell of Halifax, North Carolina, who had recently purchased 300 to 1,000 acres, depending on whose source materials you believe, of prime farmland in Robertson County along the Red River near Adams, Tennessee, with rich, dark soil that could easily support money-making crops of corn, tobacco, or cotton. The Bell family, when they had moved to Adams, Tennessee, for whatever reason came under attack by some demonic or supernatural unseen agency or entity that came to be called Kate. Other names were ascribed to the malevolent spirit, but for the duration of this video, we will simply refer to the spirit as Kate. Kate, or the spirit, never gave a clear reason as to why the Bells were targeted for capricious, malicious molestation. However, the spirit said and maintained that it had come with a sinister agenda, and that was to kill John Bell, who was widely touted to be a good and largely upstanding man. The spirit, whenever it was asked why it aimed to kill a man who, for all intents and purposes, seemed almost saintly to those on the outside looking in, Kate would simply say, "Because he deserves killing, or so I have read and been told." I don't know if anyone can say for certain the exact moment that the preternatural events first started. We know they began some 12 to 15 years after the Bells' arrival in Tennessee, but as near as anyone can reckon, the main incidents were heralded by the appearance of strange animals that seemed almost otherworldly and were stalking around the Bell family farm and lands in 1817. In later years, one of the Bell family members would recount an event that had found John Bell Sr., the patriarch of the Bell family clan, traversing his property with gun in hand, in case he should come across any wild game that might make and provide a meal for his family. John had been walking around his farm during the cooler months of the year, and I can only speculate as to the exact date that this event occurred. The date that we do know for sure is that it took place in October. The part of the story to which we do have facts states that John encountered something large and dog-like. However, some of the more embellished variations of the encounter say that the animal had a head that bore a similitude to a rabbit, but all that we know for certain is that it was large and doggish in nature. John, upon seeing the fearful aberration, raised his weapon and fired, and John, being a crack shot, expected the unknown animal to falter and die. But to his utter amazement, The eerie antagonist seemed to almost dissipate into the surrounding forest. In the highly interesting 1934 book, A Mysterious Spirit, The Bell Witch of Tennessee, medical doctor Charles Bailey Bell, who was a descendant of the Bell family, made this statement regarding the unusual creature. It looked like a dog, yet on closer inspection, he could not determine to what species it belonged. He shot at the animal, which at once disappeared. We'll be quoting this book numerous times in this video, along with its companion book on the subject, The Authenticated History of the Bell Witch, by M.V. Ingram. It is an interesting point of fact that even in this day that we live in, some 203 years later, the mysterious creatures are still frequently encountered and sighted and alleged to roam the landscapes around Adams, Tennessee and neighboring counties and communities. Some of them a mere rock's throw as the crow flies from the Bell's former homestead and abode. If you have an interest in any of those bizarre creatures and would like further information on them, please see our earlier Nightmare Nugget video on the Critter of Carr Creek. The baleful monstrosity that calls those lands around Robertson County home is said to have a very unpleasant disposition and is reportedly responsible for the cruel and seemingly vengeful deaths of several pets, and is even said to have stalked one deer hunter and even tried to trap him by pushing a tree down across a dirt road, barring his escape from the misshapen menace. It should also be noted that the possibility exists that John Bell may have, in point of fact, saw a dogman-type creature on his property instead of a conventional dog. And I'm not saying dogmatically, no pun intended, that he did see a dogman, but it makes for an interesting coincidence when you examine all the information on the subject. Firstly, we know that the creature was said to be doggish in nature, and not a normal type of dog. It was one that John, who was familiar with the land and the types of creatures that are indigenous to it, could not identify. He could not determine to what species it belonged. An interesting statement pertaining to the unsettling encounter is found in the book The Authenticated History of the Bell Witch, and it reads this way. Old Mr. Bell told my father, also John Johnson and others, that the first unaccountable object that attracted his attention was a large, strange-looking animal resembling a dog. He walked out to the field to see if the fodder was ripe enough to gather. Before starting, he cleaned his gun and loaded it to shoot squirrels and rabbits around the field. About the middle of the field, he said, he discovered the animal sitting in the row, looking intently at him. He approached nearer to it, and the dog, as he thought it was, did not move, which surprised him, and he then concluded to shoot it. At the fire of the gun, the strange-looking creature ran, and as soon as it moved, he discovered that it was an uncommon animal and knew there was no dog in the country like it. However, the circumstance was without significance and was forgotten until later developments connected it with other affairs. We would be remiss in our reporting if we didn't at least touch briefly on this next controversial aspect of the enigmatic occurrences, because we cannot ignore the fact that the entire Bell ordeal was carried out by seemingly supernatural forces, which claimed that witchcraft was involved and actually directed the strange course of events. There are also large factions of people who genuinely believe that dogmen are supernatural in nature, and are in fact creatures known as skinwalkers, which are said to be evil practitioners of dark shamanic magic, which individuals of the Native American community and culture have long proclaimed to exist, through the practice of the dark and foulest of magics. Normally, we would not make the leap from strange dog to dogman to skinwalker just because of the supernatural elements that Bell's affliction and dogman slash skinwalkers could possibly share. But Old Kate, as the spirit was called, at one time intimated that it was the spirit of an Indian whose ancient slumber had been disturbed, presumably by people who had robbed an Indian mound that was close by, and disinterred the body and scattered the bones and lost a tooth from her skull. And she, it, claimed to have come to recover the lost tooth. So we have a link between the spirit or witch and the Native Americans which believe in skinwalkers. We've even heard of those who are what is considered granny witches, summoning and conjuring up dogmen from somewhere to carry out personal yet nefarious agendas. One such account can be found on YouTube, and if you have time, you should give it a listen, We will even include a link. The video is called Bizarre Dogman Encounter, and it's on the Dogman Tapes channel. While we hold to the belief that a dogman is a flesh and blood creature, there have indeed been sightings that seem supernatural in nature, and it seems wrong to not include those just because they don't really fit into our belief system paradigm. One more quick detail before we move on is that in some variations of the account of John and the mysterious animal, the claim is made that this doggish type creature bore the head of a rabbit, giving it the description of a dog/rabbit hybrid. However, many dogman sightings describe the ears as being tall, not unlike horns, in fact, and similar in description to the long and tall ears like those of the werewolf found in the horror movie classic The Howling. There are many connections to the Bellwitch haunting and cryptids of varying types that reach all the way back across the years to the days of the Salem witch trials, and there are even possible connections to the Bell family and that historical event to which you may be surprised. Was John hallucinating? Did he see a known animal or something that he wasn't familiar with? Could it have been the witch's familiar, or could it possibly be that John Bell may have seen a dogman or other cryptids during his meanderings around the farm? For those who are unsure as to what a dogman is, I would suggest that you research into the dogman phenomenon, which seems to be growing on a daily basis. And as fantastic as it seems, many times the canine-type creatures are associated with witchcraft, and in some instances may somehow tie into old Celtic legends of Black Shuck, and creatures referred to as wolvers. We will touch more on these bizarre beasts and their ties to witchcraft later in the video. Now, we couldn't tell you for sure, with any degree of certainty, if John and his family truly saw a dogman or some other cryptid, but knowing what the family was about to endure at the hands of old Kate, it makes for a very interesting curiosity at the very least. Other local lore and legends say that some of the earlier accounts of the Bell family harassment came in the form of a large crow-like bird that was covered in thick hair as opposed to feathers. And try as they might to shoot this hateful and unclean bird, they were unable to dispatch the loathsome abomination. Maybe these creatures were some sort of phantoms that the witch manifested there betwixt the rows of corn and around the farm just to frighten the beleaguered old farmer. Who can say? But as previously stated, we will revisit these topics of cryptids and the Bell Witch later in this video, but for the moment, we will move onward. With the onset of the menagerie of mysterious beasts, other fearful and unsettling manifestations began to appear, and would continue as Betsy Bell, the beloved daughter of John Bell, would later describe seeing an unfamiliar woman walking about the family orchard, and when the figure was spoken to, she would not answer Betsy, but instead would at once disappear and evaporate like early morning fog. The curious sights picked up in frequency and intensity, and would not end for quite some time, as the supernatural activity that began outside on the surrounding property slowly moved closer and closer, eventually invading the house. The Bells would soon begin to hear a litany of unexplainable sounds in the dead of the night, starting with a mysterious rapping on the outside of the house and windows, eventually morphing into the sound of wings flapping against the ceilings inside the cabin. Whenever the sounds would begin, the family would quickly rise from whatever areas of the house they occupied and run to the door to confront the source of the knockings. But never once did they ever find the individual responsible for the disturbances, because the Bell family was looking for an intruder in the flesh, some agency with a human component, if you will. Little did the family realize that the nightly interloper was not from the world of mortal men, but rather someplace much darker and more sinister than their unsullied, naive minds could comprehend. However, they were soon fated to understand that all too well, some to the detriment of their very lives. The fearful sounds continued on a nightly basis, terrorizing everyone who resided within the simple 19th century home. Nighttime would often bring terror and dread, as the near-exhausted family would hear the sounds of vicious dogs fighting, chains dragging and rattling against the house, chairs falling over, and even the sounds of large stones dropping and slamming into the hardwood floors, emanating from inside their home. One of the noises that would perplex and confuse the family robbing them of much-needed rest, came in the form of something that sounded akin to a rat or some other vermin gnawing and chewing vigorously on the wooden furniture. The racket of those assumed teeth grinding on the furniture became impossible to ignore, and family members would arise from their beds in the dark of the night and light candles to make a thorough inspection of the room, searching for any signs of rodents that may have gained entrance into the home. However, search as they might, they would never find the source of the incessant gnawing that all too often break their sleep from them, leaving them tired and haggard the next day. Charles Bailey Bell wrote, "When lights were flashed upon the scene, the noises ceased, and not a thing out of the way could be seen, nor had any damage been done to the furniture. The unseen assailant seemed to get a sadistic glee from the knowledge that it could terribly frighten the children and adults through this avenue of attack. Since you couldn't hope to keep a candle lit all night in an era when they are far more difficult to make or procure than they are today. And if you ran out of candles, you were just out. And there was nothing that could bring back the light at that hour of the night without an immense amount of effort. Can you imagine the stark terror that one would experience lying there in the inky blackness, hearing gnawing, raspy breathing, gurgling noises as though someone were choking and giving off a death rattle as they expired? Imagine, if you will, the sound of fearsome beasts growling menacingly, with the sounds of slavering, snapping jaws coming from right beside your bed. In our modern age, when things go bump in the night, we are hesitant to cross the room to flip on a light switch. How much more bitter it must have been to attempt to kindle a flame by primitive means, while all around you were sounds of a demonic nature assailing you. Whatever malevolent force had besieged the Bell family home, it was waging a campaign of terror that today we might label as trauma-based mind control and sleep deprivation, as it gradually wearied and broke down the mental, emotional, and physical states of the hapless family. The Bells, unfortunately, found it impossible to sleep at night, even though they desperately needed sleep. And this was during an era when man or woman would generally retire for the evening shortly after the sunset, as electricity wouldn't be brought into homes until at least 1882, when Thomas Edison formed the Edison Electric Illuminating Company of New York. Even then, most Americans continued to use gaslight and candles for another 50 years. And in 1925, only half of all the homes in the United States used electric lighting. So those living in 1817 were likely not night owls, like most of modern society, benefiting from the creation and availability of artificial light. However, people of that time did have curious sleep patterns that we will look into in a few moments. My father grew up in a small mountainous region of Appalachia in the 70s, and he has often recounted to me how, even then, many homes came equipped with poor lighting, and many rooms required lamps and had little overhead lighting, which left large parts of a room obscured in darkness. He would also explain the importance of keeping extra light bulbs and fuses on hand in case you blew a bulb or fuse at night. If not, you might have had to endure a long, dark night. He tells me that in the mountains and outlying areas of the counties, that there were few street lights, and even cities were darker as businesses closed up shop much earlier. There were precious few all-night businesses. If home, cities and counties in the 70s left many with uncomfortable darkness as night fell. Just imagine the experience of the Bells as the evening gloom would settle in. We in this generation can scarcely conceive of what that may have been like, as we have access to instant artificial lighting, flashlights, chemical glow sticks, lighters, matches, candles, oil lamps, even our phones come equipped with light. Most of us have never seen or experienced true darkness like that which was a part of daily life for the unfortunate Bell family. Those who lived on the property were likely to have awoken well before the sun came up to start their day and set about their daily routines, which lasted many grueling hours. When their day was finally finished, they would usually have the evening meal and a brief time of socializing, and then retire for the evening around sunset and sleep about 4 hours. And then oftentimes they would rise up in the middle of the night and remain awake for about 2 to 4 hours. Some would even go about visiting friends and neighbors, and then return to bed to their slumber for an additional 3 to 4 hours. This practice was known as the double sleep. In fact, for most of human history, we as a people have slept in 2 blocks, not merely one. Each block of sleep would be around 4 hours or so, and as stated, individuals would remain awake for 2 to 4 hours, and then go back to bed for an additional 3 to 4 hours, as a typical night had a span of darkness that lasted anywhere from 8 to 12 hours, and this practice has played out since time immemorial, and lasted until the advent of the electric light bulb. The phenomenon of the double sleep is still practiced today in many third world countries. This historical era was undoubtedly an eerie time at best for those living in it, especially given their lack of efficient lighting, and I'm sure it produced some of the bravest of men and women that the world has ever known. Consider for a moment how many men of the time, and even women, had to get up during the dead of night because of some disturbance or because they needed to answer the call of nature and make their way outside into the inky blackness, armed with nothing but a low-powered firearm and some sort of flame-powered light source, such as a candle, torch, or oil lantern. As they fumbled their way out to the outhouse, or had to confront whatever unknown person or entity that was outside their home, causing things to go bump in the night, or perhaps square off with something trying to bring harm to their chickens or livestock, or even having to face off with brigands meaning to do them harm. This era surely produced strong, powerful examples of human bravery. However, I would say that very few ever had to deal with anything even slightly akin to what the Bell Witch Haunting produced. The terrifying events that plagued the Bell family must have been made much more bitter by the age in which the demonic oppression occurred. John Bell and his hapless family lived in an era of primitive scientific technology. There were no phones of any kind, as the first telephone wasn't even patented in the U.S. until around 1876 by Alexander Graham Bell, which meant if something of a horrific nature took place and you needed help, you couldn't just reach out and touch someone, as the old telephone commercials used to say. The only way to summon help was by going in person, and you may have had to go by night or in the rain or the snow. You couldn't have even sent a telegraph, since the Morse code hadn't yet been invented either. That creation wouldn't come into play until the 1830s, when it was brought into being by Samuel Morse. So if there's trouble of any kind, either you dealt with it yourself, or like I said a moment ago, you had to ride out yourself, be it day or night, to a neighbor's house, or a fellow individual in the community. And I can't imagine the complexities involved if you needed to find a doctor at some inconvenient hour. I've mentioned a couple of times already about the difficulties that the family must have faced when the malignant entity came calling by night. Even under the best circumstances imaginable, coming under attack by some unseen evil agency would be absolutely horrifying. But having it happen in the dark of night with little to no light would have magnified that terror exponentially. And at that time in man's history, they had few sources that could produce light. One of those sources being candles, which were probably made of animal tallow or possibly whale spermaceta, which would not have been cheap, in fact, in 1791. The Norfolk Chronicle reported the average price of all tallow for candles was 2 shillings and 6 pence for 8 pounds weight. By 1792, that price had risen to 3 shillings, and by 1817, the cost was more. But if we use the 2 shilling 6 pence measure, that is equal to 1/2 English crown, or 1/8 of an English pound, if we factor in inflation, that comes to about 10.77 pounds in 2020, or 14 American dollars, which isn't a tremendous amount, but it would have certainly been a luxury item, and not one to be wasted. Of course, even if you had plenty of candles enough to waste, you would have still had to light them in some manner. And there were only a couple of viable ways that you could have done this in 1817. But whatever method you used would have been extraordinarily slow while being accosted in a pitch-black cabin by a spiritual invader pulling the covers off of you in the cold night, while pulling your hair and slapping your face, all the while creating a bedlam of noise.
From what we've been able to ascertain,
matches did indeed exist at this time, in the form of a chemical match. The head of the match had a mixture of potassium chlorate, sulfur, sugar, and rubber, and the user would dip the match into an asbestos bottle, filled with sulfuric acid, but even this type of match was expensive for its time, and it isn't likely that John Bell or his family used them. Matches as we are familiar with today would not have existed at this point of time, as the first successful friction match was invented in 1826 by a Mr. John Walker. A couple of methods that the family could have employed during one of the many late-night visitations from the spirit, or Kate, would have been classic flint and steel. These would have been rubbed together to create a spark to ignite some combustible material. The point that I'm trying to get across is the degree of difficulty one would have had in defending themselves with a light source during the night, while the devilish Kate rampaged through the cabin. Anyone who has spent any time in a secluded or wooded area of Tennessee knows that once the sun sets, and you're surrounded and beset by a forest of trees with their heavy, lush foliage, it gets unearthly dark. Recently, we were on a research outing in Land Between the Lakes, and once the sun had moved below the horizon, it became as black as pitch, and not even the light from our campfire nor the collection of tiki torches that we employed were effective to penetrate very far into the dense, suffocating darkness of those Tennessee forests. I suspect it would have been much worse for the Bells in 1817. The mysterious rappings that had become commonplace at the Bell House usually commenced shortly after sunset and maintained their unceasing annoyance for many hours, but would oft-times relent anywhere from 1 to 3 o'clock in the morning, leaving only a couple of hours of precious sleep for those who would rise early in the morning and work on a farm for the entire day. And this disrupted sleep schedule would have been even more bitter during the winter months, when the sun set earlier, giving the demented demon a few more prime hours with which to harass the beleaguered family. I imagine the poor Bells were virtually exhausted, and this would continue for at least a year. As the torments intensified and the nightly visitations became more violent as well, as the children would proclaim that their blankets and coverings would be forcefully pulled away in the middle of the night by strong and determined hands, and no man, woman, or child in all of the Red River area would ever find the power to retain those blankets on the bed if the witch chose to remove them. And those who found sufficient strength to hold onto the covers as they were being torn away, such as John Bell Jr.'s friend Frank Miles, would find that the blanket would be ripped into pieces as the two opposing forces fought for control of the blankets. As time marched onward, the haunting sounds and nightly visitations continued day in and day out without ceasing, until reluctantly, the family would seek help and call upon one of John Bell's closest and most stalwart friends, one James Johnson, to stay the night and hopefully find an answer as to the source and origin of the malevolent entity that was harassing the family on a nightly basis. John confessed his family's woes to his most trusted confidant, and being a faithful and dedicated friend, James agreed to the unusual request, though I'm sure he didn't really expect anything of an unnatural nature to occur. But sure enough, without fail, the sounds continued during James's visit to the Bell family home, as throughout the night, the home was distressed and racked with the sounds of forceful, heavy pounding, noises akin to rats or other such vermin gnawing and scratching. There were knockings and overturned chairs, the smacking of unseen lips, and sounds of someone sucking air through their teeth. These and other anomalous sounds inundated the cabin and terrified the occupants who were listening within. After a time, James had heard enough and decided to take a stand and loudly proclaimed, "In the name of the Lord, what or who are you? What do you want? Why are you here?" In the moments following the barrage of questions that James had asked of the mysterious troublemaker, there was a brief lull in the activity and a short but terrible silence. It was almost as if the invisible malefactor was temporarily nonplussed and hadn't expected to be spoken to. Then the sounds arose again with a terrible vengeance. The spirit ruthlessly tore the blankets from those who were in bed and continued its impassioned rampage. And from that time forward, it was blatantly clear that this was no natural occurrence, but rather some sort of spiritual invader come to make mischief. John brought more and more people into his confidence in regard to his family's unusual troubles. In the days before the witch, the spirit, the entity, or whatever you choose to call it, began to speak and use its disembodied voice, those who visited the Bell's home were only able to communicate with the phantasmic fiend through a series of knockings and rappings. Of course they would speak, but the spirit would knock or rap on something as a reply. For example, one of those gathered in the room would present the spirit with questions, such as, how many individuals were standing there in the room? To which it would reply with a certain number of knocks to represent how many were present. The startling events didn't diminish at this point in time, but rather, they grew with greater intensity, and were unparalleled to any supernatural event involving a demonic spirit or entity ever known in human history up to that time, or ever since. Once the spirit finally found its voice and gave utterance, it wouldn't stop talking until the time that it decided to leave, and I would dare say that a great many individuals probably lamented and regretted that anyone had ever began to speak to it in the first place, because it was extremely loquacious and chatty, and at times it would just not shut up. I imagine that those first few people who started to dialogue with the unseen agency are the ones who encouraged the spirit to open its mouth and begin to speak. The very first intelligible sound that Kate would make, other than crazed laughter, was to mimic James Johnson's prayer that he offered up in the Bell home, and it would be repeated in James' very own voice. Sometime after the spirit gave rise to a voice, James received a nickname from the entity that became known as Kate, and that nickname was Old Sugarmouth. The spirit known as Kate, although it was very often of a violent and inflamed disposition, seemed to be deeply interested in the discussion of biblical themes and theology, and would oft times debate those people who were religious-minded and visiting the home. It was often known to quote and repeat verbatim the sermons that were preached by the pastors living in the region. However, any mistake or improperly quoted scripture would certainly be corrected by Kate, and sometimes with a scathing rebuke. It was a point of fact that there would be no misquoting the scriptures in the presence of the spirit, and Kate would have no issues debating over a sermon if it disagreed with the content or with the preacher. The spirit, it is said, would often attend the local and neighboring church services and sing hymns, apparently with great talent and beauty. Kate is said to have had a great quality and skill while singing, and some of those who heard the spirit sing would find themselves brought to tears after listening to the old witch lift up its voice in song. The spirit seemed to have a great deal of respect and reverence for the Bible and the person of Jesus Christ. As Kate made her travels around the houses of worship, woe be it to anyone that the spirit found sleeping during services, as the spirit would noise the offense abroad, and everyone far and wide across Red River would know the names of those who had succumbed to weariness and fallen asleep and was not paying attention. In every particular, this unseen agent of misery was an accuser of the brethren, and it wasn't just sleeping in church that would incur the spirit's wrathful denouncements. For a certainty, you'd best not be caught sinning, or old Kate would publish the matter far and wide. While the entity seemed to have a deep and earnest interest for religion and the things thereof, and would spend vast amounts of time discussing the Bible and the Holy Scriptures, a greater majority of the time, Kate just seemed to be in a terrible, violent mood, and would terrorize not only the family patriarch John Bell, but his daughter Betsy as well, and any other member of the Bell family that garnered the wrong side of her attention. Any member, that is, except John's wife Lucy, whom the spirit appeared to hold in high regards for some unknown reason. Kate was even prone to assault and assail those who came to visit. Of all those who felt the sting of the witch's malevolent onslaughts, John Bell without surely received more of the undiluted wrath of the sinister spirit, as it would continually shout violent obscenities when the name of John Bell came to be mentioned. And it never hid its hatred of John, nor its intention to kill the helpless old farmer. However, no one ever really knew why he became a victim of its capricious malevolence, suffering not only verbal, but the most extreme physical abuse as well. During the time of the haunting, John came under the affliction of a mysterious illness that would greatly affect his mouth, tongue, and jaw muscles, and many have theorized that this malady came directly from the hand of the Bell Witch. John claimed that it felt as though he had a stick placed sideways in his mouth. John would find himself assaulted by the slap of an invisible hand. He would writhe and contort in obvious pain, proclaiming that something was poking and prodding him with sharp pins. The abuses and terrors that were bestowed upon John, The spirit happily extended to John's daughter, Elizabeth Betsy Bell. Many a horrified, sympathetic person was made to watch helplessly as the spirit ruthlessly beat Betsy, slapping her across the face, leaving welted handprints on her, all the while roughly and unmercifully pulling her hair, and occasionally even causing other unusual afflictions, such as experiencing shortness of breath, and laying her down, almost as though she were dead, seemingly stealing away her breath for as long as a minute between gasps of air, while she lay unconscious. This torment would last for 30 to 40 minutes at a time. Betsy's the most renowned and frequented individual to have been beaten by the witch, and probably the most severely abused and set upon, despite the fact that it hated John Bell far more than anyone. Even though John and Betsy were the most afflicted by Kate, there were others that felt her preternatural menacing. It is less commonly discussed that John's son Drury suffered abuses that almost rivaled Betsy's during the demonic oppression visited upon the house. Betsy, although savagely abused by the dark and unclean spirit, seemed to garner more love and sympathy from the community, while Drury's pain and torments were largely placed on the back burner. The spirit affected poor Drury far more than most people realized, and he would never find complete and true happiness in life again. He never married for fear that the witch would find opposition to his relationship, as it did for Betsy and her first love, Joshua Gardner. I have to say that, among the litany of strange events surrounding the Bell Witch, one of the least understood aspects of the legend is surely the spirit's opposition to the relationship of Betsy Bell and Joshua Gardner. Betsy Bell, as you know, was the daughter of John Bell, and was one of the sole proprietors of the torturous cruelties dispensed by Kate during the haunting. Betsy was a devout Christian, a girl known to be quite beautiful, and apparently she was rather popular in the community. She was a blonde with a beautiful figure, lithesome, perfect complexion, rosy lips, a cheery disposition, good sense, and a perfect character. Her affections were placed on Joshua Gardner of Red River, who was a young man of an exceptional reputation. He came of a splendid family of people, was a handsome young man. He had dark hair and gray eyes, was intelligent and entertaining, and a man of good deportment, and very popular in the community. While doing my extensive research into the historical account for this video, over and over I would see the phrase, "Betsy must not marry Joshua." Betsy, do not marry Joshua Gardner, and I tell you, don't marry Joshua Gardner. According to the testimony of one James G. Burns, the spirit allegedly made the unusual statement, telling the family that if Betsy would marry a certain gentleman, it would leave and not trouble them any more. Which is quite perplexing, since in other passages it is quoted as saying, "I will not leave as long as old Jack Bell lives." Nonetheless, it being of a demonic and deceptive nature, it really doesn't surprise me that it gave these opposing statements. It was a very shocking thing for the community to hear the words of the spirit condemning the love of these two young people, who seemed genuinely fond of each other. Joshua loved Betsy to such a degree that he was willing to face all the tempestuous rage of the witch. But Betsy, although her love for him was equal to his feelings for her, had serious forebodings regarding their union, and she believed that to marry would put both of them into serious danger. The curses of Kate were especially shocking when you consider the high standing and reputations that both of the youths had achieved during their brief lives in Red River. According to the Charles Bailey Bell book, Kate had privately conveyed to John Jr. that Betsy would do better not to marry him. Regardless of anything I may do, future generations will prove it to be so. And it never confirmed for sure if it would continue to harass and torment if she took Joshua's hand in marriage. Needless to say, after all the vile mercies administered by the witch, it was with a heavy heart that she, Betsy, chose not to marry Joshua for fear that the witch would follow her and her beloved throughout their lives if she had done contrary to the malevolent spirit's wishes. Instead of giving in to the inclinations of her own youthful passions, she eventually surrendered to the genuine tender affections of her professor, Richard Powell, who she would end up sharing a happy life with, Even though there were bitter moments throughout that life, such as the deaths of multiple children, so far as I know, it has never been stated as to whether the Bell Witch supported or opposed her union to Richard Powell, whom she would in time leave Tennessee with and start a new life with in another state, where she would live until she passed away on July 11th, 1888, at the ripe old age of 82. Her husband, Richard Powell, passed away in 1848, some 40 years earlier. Betsy was laid to rest in Yallabusha County, Mississippi. It is said of her life that she retained a great deal of terror for the Bell Witch, never sleeping alone if possible, and choosing to sleep safely against the wall with a person on the other side of her, boxing her in safely. It was never known or understood why the supernatural offender held such great contention to the union of these two youths. However, in addition to the warnings for future generations against a Betsy and Joshua marriage, the entity is said to have relayed to John Bell Jr. this nebulous warning: if she marries Joshua, she can never have a day of happiness or peace. That is certain. Following the haunting, Drury retained complete and terrible faith that some unfortunate day the witch would return, and he lived in continual fear that the disembodied voice would once more come calling to whisper to him, announcing its unwelcomed and devilish return into his life. And so he lived out the remainder of his sad life as a haunted and broken man. The Bell Witch, as it was known, had a nature that was something of a dichotomy at best. While it displayed great acts of hatred, brutality, and violence toward John, Drury, and Betsy, it seemed to show great care and affection for the wife of John Bell, Lucy Bell, as previously mentioned. Perhaps the great affection that it heaped upon Lucy Bell was merely another devious method by which it carried out cruelty, by abusing and tormenting her children and her husband, while showing continued mercy. Imagine what daggers of emotional pain would be driven into your heart and soul as those you loved most were beset upon and tortured and tormented by something evil from the realms of darkness, while you were the recipient of kindness and tender affection. How they must have pained that good and godly wife and mother, watching as the fierce arrows of affliction were hurled at her loved ones, while she was gifted with gentle mercies. Lucy Bell, without a doubt, received the least amount of abusive chastisement that was parceled out by the witch, at least in a physical manner of speaking. It often called her loose in a loving manner, and even went so far as to bring her fresh fruits, such as grapes or hazelnuts, during a most serious time in her life when she had fallen ill and was near death. The hazelnuts from the hand of the witch seemed to come from nowhere, literally falling into her lap, materializing, it seemed, from the ceiling, a gift given by an unseen hand, mystifying those present, I'm sure. Lucy, while in her debilitated and weakened condition, had lacked the strength necessary to break the hazelnuts on her own, and it was at this time that the witch would show kindness and begin to break apart the shells so she could eat and regain her waning strength. As mysterious as it sounds, Lucy Bell actually began to recuperate by eating the foods that she had been gifted by the attentive spirit, who, when Lucy Bell entered into the latter stages of her sickness, helped to take the ailing woman's mind off her malady by singing her songs of a most beautiful nature that were so haunting and melodic that they reduced those in attendance to tears. One of the songs that the spirit often sang actually contained some of the saddest words ever penned in the history of music.
Come, my heart, and let us try for a little season. Every burden to lay bare, come and let us reason. What is this that cast you down? Who are those that grieve you? Speaking, let the worst be known. Speaking may relieve you. Christ by faith I sometimes see, and he doth relieve me. But my fears return again. These are they that grieve me. Trouble like the restless sea, people faint and fearful, plagued with every sort of disease. How can I be cheerful?
Imagine the implications of these words pouring forth from the lips of the almost certain fallen angel who had once abode in a much loftier estate before being cast out. I say this because the spirit heavily intimated at times that it was in fact a demonic agent, which is nothing more than a fallen angel. This song was quoted from A Dialogue Between a Believer and His Soul, from the year 1759 by Joseph Hart. The poem took inspiration from the scriptures, and it was around 10 stanzas long or so. It is said by Richard Williams Bell, son of John Bell, that no rhythmical sound or melody ever fell upon the ear with sweeter pathos, coming as it did like a volume of symphony from a bursting heart. The Bell Witch Haunting is one of the most fantastic paranormal events to have ever taken place in the history of mankind, and the event is massive in its scope. So massive, in fact, that just to tell an abridged version of the mysterious matters will take multiple videos, and this is just the first in the series. So, when you're ready, please continue on to part 2 of Season of the Witch, the Bell Witch story, and we will pick back up where we have left off.